The bottom line is for our district, for the 6th district, a rural district deserves rural representation. I mean, that's all there is to it. The progressive left, they want to ban certain firearms. They want to repeal the tax cuts. They want Medicare for all, which would fundamentally change Medicare as we know it. They want to impeach the President of the United States and Judge Kavanaugh, and they're going to do all of this stuff by voting for Nancy Pelosi for Speaker if they were to take the House. So there is a huge, huge difference between all of the candidates out there, and those are just a stretch of few of them.
Now, in this district, it is a largely rural district. I was just looking at the breakdown of the numbers, though, and there are more urban voters in the district than rural voters. You say that a rural district deserves rural representation, but what about those non-rural voters?
Well, they aren't urban voters. They're suburban voters, and they want the very same things that that every individual wants. They want to make sure that the economy continues to roll along as it is. They do not want to lose those tax cuts. They do not want to see a president impeached. They do not want to see Medicare changed. They do not want to see bans on firearms or coming after our Second Amendment rights. But when it comes to those rural voters, the bottom line is, agriculture is the number one industry in this district by far, the number one industry. And what's more, it's the number one industry for every consumer out there. Every single person depends on agriculture 3 times a day, mm-hmm. whether they realize it or not. Every single person. And so, that's what I do. That's what I have always done. That is what, what I do for a living is I farm. And I know what farmers are going through. I know what agriculture is about. And I know how hard it is to represent those interests. And somebody from, somebody that grew up inner city, that they're not going to represent that.
So we've talked a lot about agriculture and farm issues. So let's focus on that. Congress was not able to pass a farm bill. It didn't make it over the line, I believe, September 30th. Now, I understand there may have been some politics, but if people take a look at that and they say, well, why didn't that get done? What happened there? Why was there no farm bill? Will that happen again if Republicans retain control? And also, just to follow up on that, a farmer in the area just a couple of days ago who says that if the tariffs that are in place now continue the trend that they have, he could be looking at a shortfall of more than $300,000 at the end of this quarter. And he voted for Trump, and he now says that Trump will not have his vote in the future. Are you worried about voters like that?
No, I'm not. In fact, we've already got trade agreements with Mexico and Canada. So putting the North American trade agreement back into place now, which is much, much better than it used to be. And that's what the president's after. He's after fair trade, mm-hmm. Not just free trade. And our trading partners weren't playing fair. You had Canada saying they wanted open trade, but don't bring any of your dairy into Canada. Mm-hmm. So that hurt every dairy farmer out there that lost those markets. Now it's going to be open trade. So those are just a couple of examples. Now, the reason the farm bill didn't pass is real simple. And that comes down to the progressive left blocking it because there's a requirement in there that if you receive food stamps and you are able-bodied, then you're going to be required to work at least 20 hours a week. Mm-hmm. That's half a work week, to be quite honest with you. And so I don't think that's too much to ask an individual that's receiving tax dollars in the form of aid is to work 20 hours. So, that progressive left, they block that, and they do not want a food policy, farm policy, with that in there. So that's what the fight comes down to, and I think the answer to that's real simple.
Now, there has been real success with the renegotiation of NAFTA with Canada and Mexico. That is true. That is a fair assessment. But there has been real market turmoil lately, and farmers are concerned. They are concerned about these tariffs with China and about them being in term long place. Have you spoken to the president about those concerns that farmers do have?
Oh, absolutely. And the truth of the matter is, and farmers, we all know that this is harvest time, And soybeans and corn are commodities, so they are very volatile markets. And I can guarantee without a doubt that the prices are going to go back up, and I can guarantee without a doubt that the prices are going to go back down. Mm-hmm. That's what prices do on commodities. And what the traders on the floor will do is they'll take advantage of every situation that they can. If they make money, whether the market's going up or going down, depending on whether they short or they long those commodities. So the bottom line is, it's all about volatility. That's what the traders want. So unfortunately, what happens with us that are in agriculture, we are price takers on both ends. We have to take the price quoted to us for all of our inputs, and we have to take the price quoted to us for all of our outputs. We have no control whatsoever. It's one of the few industries that is set up like that, which is one of the reasons why we have farm policy, and one of the reasons why it is so important, and it maintains that affordable food supply, safe food supply, and very abundant food supply out there. So farmers understand that, and they know, you know, China has never played by the rules, ever, and China needs us every bit as much as we need them. That's the reason China's at the table right now discussing a new trade agreement, and it will happen. The president's confident of it, and I'm confident of it.
Okay, and just really quickly before I let you go, now there, like you said, there's a real possibility that Democrats could take control of the House this time around. How concerned are you that that might actually be the outcome?
That's not going to be the outcome. I've seen the numbers, and mm-hmm. There is no blue wave, so to speak. That would be the narrative that many would want you to believe, but the fact of the matter is, it is not what's taking place. And again, I've seen the numbers. And in Missouri in particular, it certainly won't be the case here. And so I'm pretty confident, and I'm looking forward to getting back to work.